the problem of non-interacting electrons in a periodic potential. Okay, so in that sense, I was asking you what exactly is the philosophy of the problem, and that means what I mean to ask then is what is the basis from which we start. Okay, so normally, see, if you say that these are free electrons, then for free electrons, what are wave functions? What are the eigenfunctions of a free electron?
The momentum wave functions.
These are plane waves, right?
Plane waves, exponentials.
So the thing is, if we start from a plane wave solution, okay, and we can expand any given wave function in terms of plane waves, right?
Yeah.
So that is not the tight binding approach. Okay, the point is the tight binding approach takes the philosophy that let us start from the atomic limit. So there are two extreme limits that one has to consider. Okay, one is one of the limits is that there is an empty box and electrons are moving freely. Okay, the other limit is that you put in the electrons are actually associated with atoms, and these atoms are very far to begin with, and we are bringing them closer and closer. Do you get the idea?
Okay.
So there are two limits to solve the problem. Okay. One is the free electron limit, and the other is localized electron limit. By which we mean that electrons here are in a box. Okay, that box can have periodic boundary conditions, open boundary conditions, it's okay, any of them, versus electrons which are, you know, going around, or there is some wave function, and these electrons are localized on particular, on specific atoms. Okay, so these two limits, do you see that these two limits are orthogonal to each other? They are two extremes of the problem, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So in one case, there are no atoms. It's just free electrons moving around. Okay, no periodic potential. So here, when we bring back the periodic potential, the natural basis in which to expand the wave function will be the plane waves, because those plane waves were eigenstates of the problem before the periodic potential came in. Okay.
Just 1 second, sir. So our last class was on 2nd December, I think.
Okay.
That we discussed the chronic penny model.
No, after that, we had a tight binding model class also. I looked up. We derived the equations. Remember, we said that let's define Wannier orbitals. Correct? You remember? So that's the 21st lecture. So Saptarishi, please correct me if I'm wrong.
No, sir. Last class was on 3rd December.
And that was where we considered Wannier orbitals, right?
Yes, yes.
And the tight binding approach.
Yes, sir.
So basically what I'm trying to say is that here we are starting from a localized electron limit, where electrons are assigned to individual atoms, and then we start bringing these atoms closer and closer to each other. Okay, so imagine a gas of atoms where the electrons are associated with each atom individually, and now we bring these atoms closer and closer. Okay, and place them in crystalline positions. Okay, close to each other in such a way that the wave functions will start to overlap. Okay, so here the the wave function has to be a linear superposition of the atomic wave functions. Okay, I'll explain these indices, just give me 1 minute. Does this make things clearer? Okay, see here, these ones, okay, this is a block state. Okay, we know that the eigenfunctions of electrons moving in a periodic potential have to be block states. Okay, that comes from the Bloch's theorem. The thing is, what we are doing here is that we are expanding this Bloch state in terms of localized atomic orbitals located in the mth unit cell. So m is a unit cell index. Okay, and alpha is a certain atom or an orbital. So let me give you an example. Okay, imagine a crystal where, let's say, take 1D for example, okay? And in 1D, let's say that we had these unit cells, and in each unit cell, there were two atoms. Both of them had one orbital each. So this could be, for example, loosely speaking, a H2 crystal, 1D hydrogen atom crystal, okay? Just for simplicity, assume this. So A and B are the two different orbitals to which electrons can belong, right?
Sir, and
what is, yes, Shobhit.
Sir, I did not receive the link. So can you just repeat what you have said in this class in just brief?
Which link are you talking about?
Google Microsoft team meeting links.
Oh, okay. Huh. Yeah. So what I was saying was that we are basically working with two different limits. See, when we try to solve the problem, when we try to solve the Schrodinger's equation of non-interacting electrons moving in a periodic potential, we can start from two different limits. Okay, one is the free electron limit, and the other one is a localized electron limit, right? In the free electron limits, the electrons are free to move about in a full box with no periodic potential, okay? In the other limit, the atoms are already placed in some periodic way, but they are very far from each other. So the electrons are localized to individual atoms. Okay. And in this case, in the free electron limit case, you can imagine the bringing in the periodic potential and then slowly turning it on. Okay. In the localized electron limit case, you can imagine shrinking the crystal in such a way that the atoms now come closer to each other, and the wave functions will start to overlap. Okay, so these are two extreme limits. And what I was saying was that in the localized electron limit, which is where the tight binding approach works, what one has to do is one has to construct these block states, which are the eigenfunctions of the full problem, as a linear superposition of the atomic orbitals. Okay, is that clear? That's all I said, nothing more. And then explaining what these different indices are. So this psi k here is a block state, okay? And I was giving an example where, let's say, consider a 1D crystal where where these A and B are, let's say, S orbitals, and the A is a hydrogen atom, B is also a hydrogen atom, okay? So it's a 1S orbital, 1S orbital, 1S orbital, 1S orbital, and so on, okay? So this M is a unit cell index. So this could be, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is M. Okay, and the alpha could be A or B. Okay, so what we are doing here is that we are constructing this block state out of a linear superposition of these different orbitals as well as of different unit cells. Okay, so imagine the entire crystal having different unit cells. We are taking the atomic orbitals of each atom in each unit cell, and then associating some phase factor with it, which is the e to the power I k dot rm alpha, and then multiplying another factor, which is basically related to the, or it's basically giving you the weight of that orbital, okay? So each orbital will carry certain amplitude, and that could be different. For example, this could have a greater weight, this could have a smaller weight, and so on. But you will see that actually this B alpha factor is going to be crucial in determining the full band structure of the material. Okay, so that we will see later. But is this superposition clear, that we are creating a superposition of the localized atomic orbitals rather than creating a superposition of the plane waves? Okay, so that's the main difference between these two, between the free electron limit and between the localized electron limit. Okay, So if I mean, if this statement is clear, then we can move ahead. Does anybody have any doubt in this? No, right? Okay, good. Now let me restate the problem that we were trying to solve. Okay. For this, I will ask. Is Dipanjana online? Hello, Dipanjana, are you online?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. So, Dipanjana, were you there in the last class when we did the tight binding approach?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So, so tell me, what is the, again, this particular wave function ansatz is will be useful in solving the whole problem. But the question that I'm going to ask you is, what was the problem that we were trying to solve? I have already stated that. Right?
Yes, sir.
What was the problem? Why are we doing all this? I can't hear you.
Sorry, sir. Can you repeat the problem? That was like the problem that we are dealing with?
Yes. What was the problem that we were trying to solve?
I'm not very sure, sir, because I haven't really gone through the notes.
No problem. See, the thing is, we are trying to solve the problem of electrons moving through a periodic potential. That's all. It's as simple as that. Okay. See, you have solved in first particle, in single particle quantum mechanics, you have solved the problem of electrons moving through barriers and so on, right? Which is what we did in the Kronig-Penney model, correct? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now we have a sequence of barriers, okay? And those barriers can have very complicated form.
Okay.
Okay? But we have a reference point. The reference point is that each electron, We can assume that each electron belongs to a certain orbital in the isolated atom limit. Okay. For example, I can take an isolated sodium atom. Okay. In an isolated sodium atom, tell me what is the electronic configuration?
1s2.
Okay.
2s2. 2p6.
Okay.
3s1.
Correct. So 1s2, 2s2. 2p6 and 3s1, right? Now, these are all filled, right?
Yes, sir.
And this is what we call the valence electron, right? Okay. So, I can take the sodium to be composed of a core, okay, and an electron which is outside moving around in a 3s1 orbital. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And the problem that I am trying to solve now is this kind of a sodium atom, okay, if there are 10 to the power 23 sodium atoms sitting in some crystalline positions, but then they are very far from each other, okay? And then I start shrinking the crystal and then bringing these atoms closer and closer to each other so that the wave functions, the 3s wave function of one atom starts overlapping with the 3s wave function of the other atom, okay, and so on. Only then the bands will form. Otherwise, the isolated electronic levels will be the energy levels of the entire system.
Okay.
Do you see the point?
So then from when these overlap happens, does that lead to the orbital theory, the molecular orbital theory?
Correct. So if you had, let's say, two atoms, then you would just consider molecule formation.
Okay.
If you had 10 to the power 23 atoms, you would think of it as band formation. That's all.
Okay.
So when you have only two orbitals and you have, let's say, one hydrogen atom, another hydrogen atom, you would call it a bonding and an antibonding, right? But if you had 10 to the power 23 of them, then you have a continuum of energy levels, and that's what we call bands.
Band.
Okay. So, yeah. Okay, now let's move on to, yeah, Sohini, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Sohini, there was one particular way in which we had written the full Schrodinger's equation. Do you remember that? We had split the Hamiltonian into two parts. Based on this philosophy that the block state is being constructed out of the atomic orbitals, we had split the Hamiltonian into two different parts. Do you remember what those parts were? Or can you?
Yes. Was exactly solvable and the other one was a perturbation term.
Exactly. So one is exact plus one is perturbation. And based on this ansatz, right? The ansatz that we have chosen is to expand the block state in terms of atomic orbitals, right? And these atomic orbitals are exact wave functions of something. Of what?
Of the atoms.
Of the atomic Hamiltonian, right?
Yes.
Correct. So, which means that this H exact has to be H atomic, right?
Yes.
So this H atomic means that, you know, the all the periodic potential that the electron of that atom feels, for example, there could be kinetic energy terms also, right? And so on. So this H atomic is basically defined in such a way that if I act on chi m alpha, then I will get E alpha chi m alpha. Okay, this is the definition of H atomic. Do you agree with this?
Yes.
Why isn't there an M here in the E alpha? Why didn't I write an M?
It is independent of the unit cell we are considering.
Very good. Because this is a completely periodic crystal and there is no disorder in the system and all the atoms are identical to each other, right? There could be, however, different kinds of atoms, which is what is taken care of by the alpha index. Right? For example, there could be an NaCl crystal. We could be considering an NaCl crystal, in which case the alpha will take care of whether the electron, whether we are considering here a chlorine orbital or whether we are considering a sodium orbital. Okay. In some cases, what can happen is an individual atom can itself supply multiple orbitals. Okay. So for example, the d orbital of some atom as well as the s orbital of some atom, both of them could be participating in crystal formation. Okay, so in which case then we have to distinguish between the orbitals corresponding to a particular atom and the orbitals corresponding to the other atoms, right? So yes, very nice. And then do you remember what, how we understand this perturbation term?
It was kinetic energy and potential energy on due to the other atoms.
Very nice. Okay. So the perturbation is basically because this electron, let's say, which corresponds to this atom and this electron, which corresponds to this atom and so on. Now, when these atoms come closer and closer, then there will be an interaction between this and this, right? And so on. So this will also start feeling this, for example, and so on, right? So that is good. And that is what is delta U. Correct? That's yes. What we call delta U. Now, tell me, why didn't we consider this interaction? The electrons would also repel each other, isn't it?
Yes.
Why did we not consider that interaction? In the delta U, should we consider that also? What do you think?
No, because we are just considering the linear superposition of the atomic orbitals here.
Okay, so your answer is pointing to the correct answer. So let me rephrase what you are saying. Okay, we are here considering only single particle orbitals or single particle wave functions. And because of that, we are expanding that in terms of the atomic orbitals. If we start looking at electron-electron interactions, electron-electron repulsions, we would have to consider many body wave functions. Okay. So the whole idea of this problem is that we are considering non-interacting electrons in a periodic potential. So each electron is acting independent of the other electron. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the whole problem that we are trying to solve is non-interacting electrons in a periodic potential. Okay. So that's the reason why we neglect this electron-electron interaction. Okay. So to keep this a single particle problem, as soon as we bring in electron-electron interactions, it becomes a many-particle problem. Okay. Also remember that we have ignored the dynamics of these cores of the periodic potential. So the periodic potential is considered to be static and given. If we had brought in finite temperature, can you tell me what would happen? Or if we bring in the dynamics of the ions of the cores, what would happen? Will the periodic potential be static?
No.
Why? Answer is right. You should just speak, okay? Whatever you're thinking of, you just speak. It could be right or wrong, but whatever you are imagining in your head, right, you just tell me. Let's see if that picture is correct or not. Why do you think the periodic potential will not be static?
There would be more perturbations.
Why would there be more perturbations? So the question that I asked you is, if the ions start moving, right, which means that there are lattice vibrations, will the periodic potential be static? That was the question.
I'm not sure.
It's okay. It's okay to be not sure. But whatever you're imagining, you can just say that. Okay. It could be a very naive observation, but just say it. What would happen if the atoms start moving? Will the periodic potential remain periodic?
No, it shouldn't.
It shouldn't, right? Okay. In fact, it will become time dependent. Do you agree?
Yes.
See, depending on what kind of a phonon mode you are considering. For example, I could consider a particular phonon mode where these two are moving towards each other, right? And the next two are moving towards each other, okay? So at some particular instant, what can happen is that these two atoms are far from each other and these two atoms are closer to each other. So in which case the periodic potential is the same as when these atoms are placed at fixed positions at a distance A from each other. Okay. So if you consider finite temperature when there is random thermal motion, or when the motion can be considered as a superposition of a large number of phonon modes, then you can see that there is absolutely the concept of a periodic potential has to be thrown out. Okay. However, it so happens that we can still consider the concept of band theory and band structure at finite temperature, even though the periodic potential concept itself doesn't exist. Okay. So that is itself an approximation. Do you understand?
Yes,
that
sir.
The use of band structure at any finite temperature, in fact, even at zero temperature, we have to consider zero point motion. Okay. And zero point motion does disrupt this concept of the periodic potential. But we ignore that. We consider the lattice to be completely rigid. And then because we consider the lattice to be completely rigid, the periodic potential is absolutely periodic. And hence we have the Bloch's theorem. And hence we can do all that we are doing. Is this point clear?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. You can mute yourself. So with all this, now let me just recapitulate the equations. So what we were doing was that we were trying to solve this problem. Okay. Let me ask. Purnendu, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, Purnendu, what is the psi k here?
It's the linear combination of atomic orbitals.
Sure. But this is electrons moving in a periodic potential, and the psi k is an eigenfunction. So, what theorem should it satisfy?
Bloch theorem.
Bloch's theorem, right? So, it should be a Bloch state, correct?
Yes, sir.
And we had written the psi k as a linear superposition of this. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, so in this linear superposition, you see there are these two factors. Okay. So, what does this Rm, what does this e to the power I k dot Rm alpha do? Why have we included this here? Can you tell me? Why did I not just write Bm alpha chi m alpha? I mean, I could have written this as some Cm alpha chi m alpha, right? If I wanted to just write a linear superposition, that is what I should have written. Why did I separate out the e to the power I km dot Rm alpha?
So that it satisfies the Bloch theorem.
Very nice. Okay. So if we now substitute, you know, R plus some lattice vector R, then you would get an e to the power I k dot R out, right? And that would satisfy the Bloch's theorem. Very nice. So this particular form of the linear superposition has been written in such a way that it automatically satisfies the Bloch's theorem. Okay. And now if I substitute this into this, okay, then we would get, okay, yeah, you can mute yourself. I'll ask later. So now there is a summation. Yeah, do you have a question? Was there a question?
No, no, sir.
Okay, okay, fine. Okay, so this is EK. Sum over m alpha b alpha e to the power this all right so now want to ask Shovik, are you online? Shovik, yes, can you hear me? Yeah, okay.
Yes, sir.
So I want to take a scalar product here with some other orbital and sitting in some other unit cell, okay, sitting in some specific unit cell. So let's say I consider the nth unit cell and the betaith orbital in that unit cell, okay? And I want to take this equation, right, and write a matrix element of this equation with the orbital which belongs to the nth unit cell and the betaith orbital. So can you tell me what should I do?
Sir, we should multiply chi n beta from left side in both sides.
Okay, fine. So what I'll do is m alpha b alpha e to the power I k dot r m alpha, and then chi n beta h atomic plus delta u, and then chi m alpha, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And this should be equal to m alpha b alpha e to the power I k dot r m alpha and then chi n beta chi m alpha, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So by the way, I'm using Dirac notation. Is there anyone who is not familiar with the Dirac notation? Good. So everyone is familiar. If you find any difficulty with this, please let me know later, okay, and I can clarify your doubt separately, right? But basically, if we write this as if we write the wave function as this, then this is an abstract notation. So but this is basically a vector, okay, or a ray in Hilbert space, and you can consider any particular representation of this by taking this kind of a scalar product, okay, and I will be sending out a Google form later in which you can indicate your interest on whether to attend the second quantization class or not. But basically, for second quantization, knowing the Dirac notation will be a prerequisite. Okay. So, okay. So, Shovik, going back to this, can you tell me what I should do next?
Sir, in atomic Hamiltonian, we should use the energy eigenvalue of the atomic energy level. That means capital E, n alpha delta nm delta alpha beta.
Okay. Now, what you are assuming here is this. So, this is, if I write this, then the here you're assuming this is En beta, okay, and then delta Nm delta alpha beta. Correct? You're assuming this, right? Okay.
Yes.
Now, I have a question for you, okay? Suppose I consider two atoms and then 1s orbital here and a 1s orbital here. Okay. And this H atomic, of course, this chi n beta is an eigenfunction of this, and this is also an eigenfunction of this. So this En beta will come out for sure. Okay. So let's let H atomic act on this chi n beta, and this En beta will come out. In fact, the n index is not there, right? Because every unit cell, it's the same atom. Yeah. Okay, so this is just E beta, let's say. The question is this correct or not? Okay, so let's find out. So this you're arguing that chi n beta overlap with chi m alpha should be equal to delta n m delta alpha beta. Correct, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so n and m are unit cells. Okay.
Different unit cells and their corresponding orbitals, alpha, beta.
So they could be same also. So there is a case when n is equal to m, then it is definitely 1. The question is, when n is not equal to m, is it 0?
So there, we can use some constant value depending on the size, the multiplication factor or constant, any constant. That means delta mn and delta alpha beta, it is not delta function, but a constant value, less than 1.
No, wait. Hold on. Go step by step. Let's first think about nearest neighbors. Okay. The what I said was, we are thinking of this as a tight binding approach, which means the 1s orbital here and the 1s orbital here, they will start to overlap. And only when they start to overlap, will you actually get the formation of bands? I said that, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now if I take the chi 1 1s, chi 2 1s, right? Which means this is unit cell 1 and this is unit cell 2. And I take the overlap of these two, will this be always 0?
No, there is some overlap.
There will be some overlap, right? And for nearest neighbors, there will be the max. There will be maximum overlap, right? For next nearest neighbors, the overlap will be less.
Decreasing.
Yeah, exponentially small, right?
Yeah.
However, that can also exist, and even next to next nearest neighbors, and so on. In fact, when we do practical calculations using density functional theory, what we find is not only nearest neighbor, but we also have to consider 3 to 4 different shells. Okay, the nearest neighbor shell in 3D, the next nearest neighbor, next to next nearest neighbor, up to 3rd to 4th neighbor shell. Okay, we have to consider almost 3 to 4 nearest neighbor shells if we want to get the accurate band structure. Okay, so this is not correct. Okay, there is no delta function here. So let's just modify this. Okay, and here we will write chi n beta chi m alpha. Is that clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So can you tell me what should be my next step here? So I can take this out, right? So H atomic will act on this and give me E beta. So that comes out because that is not in the summation. Okay, and here also I have a chi n beta chi m alpha. You see that, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So can I now take this part, the atomic part, on the other side and combine it with the EK?
Yeah.
I can do that, right? Yeah. So what I'm going to do is to take this whole thing and then combine it with this, because the H atomic acts on the chi n beta, gives out the E beta, and then the chi n beta, chi m alpha scalar product remains, which is exactly the same thing here also. Okay, so I can combine this and I get Ek minus E beta sum over m alpha b alpha e to the power I k dot r m alpha, and then here you have chi n beta chi m alpha. Okay, that is yeah.
Sir, epsilon k minus epsilon beta, should it not be within the summation, and as we are summing over m alpha, it should not it be alpha for just
okay. So here, see, the thing is, you could have considered this within the summation if you acted this on the right hand side. Okay, so there are two equivalent formulations here, and both should give you the same result, right?
Yes.
So what I have done here is to consider the H atomic action on the chi n beta, which is why I could get this out of the summation. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, yeah. Sir.
So you can consider H atomic to act on the chi m alpha, in which case you will get the E alpha here, and then it will not be able to come out of the summation. True.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And yes. In both cases, you will see that for a multi-orbital problem, you will get a matrix which is identical. Okay, that is still true. So that is not very obvious, but you can write it down explicitly, and you will see that. Maybe we'll try to do an example also. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So on this side, we will get B alpha e to the power I k dot r m alpha chi n beta, and this particular equation has a nice interpretation. We will discuss that now. So this is the equation that we get out of this whole thing. Okay, so to interpret this, let me ask. So Disha, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so Disha, can you interpret this equation in the sense that, suppose, I mean, the philosophy of this was that we have these atoms which are placed in crystal positions, but they are very far from each other, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So imagine the limit when they are really, really far from each other. Okay. What happens to the right hand side of this equation?
Delta U would be zero.
Okay. What happens to the left hand side then?
So Ek will be equal to Eb.
Ek will be equal to E beta.
Yeah, beta.
But so, what about the term in the summation? Will that also not be equal to zero?
It okay. There will be there wouldn't be any overlap. So only it'll be what Shaubik had said: delta alpha beta delta n m.
Okay, correct. So if that is the case, correct. So that would then be, so the term inside the summation, or the summation itself, this particular term, will that, what will that be finally? In the case when the atoms are really far from each other?
In this, it will be one.
Are you sure?
One second.
This will be one. This will
be
delta nm and delta alpha beta. But then will this not reduce this to n beta? The rm alpha will reduce to n beta, right?
Yeah.
And the because b alpha will reduce to b beta.
Yeah.
Correct? So b beta e to the power I k dot r n beta is what will remain. And then ek minus e beta.
Yeah.
This will become equal to zero. This is in the isolated atom limit. What I want to check here is, does this tight binding problem reduce to the correct isolated atom limit when I take the atoms far from each other? Okay. And you have to show me that it does.
Okay. Can you? Won't Ek be equal to E beta because Because e to the power I that is that has modulus 1, it cannot
correct.
Be
that
zero.
Is never equal to 0 exactly. Yeah. What about b beta?
B beta, that's a coefficient.
Mm-hmm.
It can.
So that's a coefficient in the linear superposition, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And why shouldn't that be zero?
The contribution of
yes,
d beta is the only contribution, right?
From the beta-th orbital.
Yeah, and exactly. That cannot be zero, right? Because
correct. So since we have considered, I mean, we have done a construction, right? By construction, we have said that the alpha orbital, the beta orbital, whatever orbitals are there, each of them is contributing some finite magnitude to the block state, right? So by construction, we have assumed that these b coefficients should not be zero, in which case ek will be equal to e beta. Okay, correct. So does this reproduce the isolated atom limit?
Yes, it does, because ek because xi k is the eigen function, right?
Okay. So that will turn out to be equal to chi m beta, chi beta.
Yeah.
Correct? Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other thing is that this ek, does the band now depend on the k at all?
Not really.
It doesn't, right? It's dispersionless.
Yeah.
If it is dispersionless, what will be the group velocity or the phase velocity? Let's consider group velocity, okay?
If it's dispersionless, then it should be a constant.
So grad ek, if ek doesn't depend on the k at all, what will this be?
That should be zero.
It should be zero, right? So yeah. What does that tell you about the propagation of electrons?
The velocity is a constant because
is zero, right? The velocity is zero. The group velocity is zero.
Group velocity is zero. Yeah.
Which means the electrons are not propagating.
Yeah.
Which is true because we have started from the isolated atom limit.
They're localized.
They're localized. Absolutely. So we started from the isolated, I mean, we said that we start from the isolated atom limit, we bring the atoms closer, let them overlap. But then finally, when we get the equation, we want to see whether by making the overlap zero, do we get back to the isolated atom limit or not? Okay, so this is a kind of a benchmarking exercise that we just did. Okay, do we get back those isolated atoms? And indeed we do. That was this whole thing. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Any doubts so far? No? Okay. All right. So this is the equation that we need to solve. All right. So let me ask. Ashish, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Ashish, what is the known here and what is the unknown here?
M and alpha are known.
M and alpha.
B alpha is the unknown.
Sorry, B is the unknown.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let me write that one second. So the unknowns and the knowns, okay, in this equation, that is what you have to tell me, right? So right. B alphas are unknown, correct? For all alpha. Right. Okay.
Yes, yes.
Anything else unknown?
E beta is also unknown.
E beta is unknown, okay. What is known? Go ahead.
Delta U will be known here. And
delta U is known. Okay. What about the chi? Are the chi's known or unknowns?
These are known, sir.
Chi are also known. Okay. So chi m alpha is also known for all m and all alpha. Okay. What about the capital R m alpha? Are they known or unknown?
Known, sir.
They are known. Okay. So that is also known. What about Ek?
Ek is also unknown.
Ek is unknown?
No, sir. Ek is known, sir.
Is it known?
Because we are using block states here.
Okay, huh?
Because these are block states we are using cycles. Okay. So we can have Ek from there.
Okay, so what is Ek then? If it is known, so okay, first let me just put this here. Okay, so you said Ek is known, right? Now, if Ek is known, let's go over each of them. So the delta U is part of the periodic potential and it's known, but I can't give you the form. For example, it could be a very complicated form. Okay, so let me not go into that now, but assume that it is known. Okay, when you said chi m alpha is known, what is the form of those? Why did you say chi m alpha were known? Do we know their form?
Chi m alpha will be periodic there.
Chi m alpha are periodic? So remember, we constructed the block state in this way, right?
Right, sir.
So the left hand side is a block state. What is this? What did I say this was?
Localized.
This is localized. This is localized atomic orbital.
Yes, sir.
And we did this linear superposition in this way because the chi m alpha were exactly known to us.
Right, right.
But how do we know them? By solving the isolated atom problem.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so imagine a hydrogen crystal. Okay, in a hydrogen crystal, imagine putting these hydrogen atoms far from each other and then bringing them closer. So the hydrogen atom has orbitals which are 1s, 2s, 2p, and so on. Okay, so this chi m alpha could be, for example, the 1s orbital, which you know exactly.
Yes.
Okay, so the chi m alpha is known. Now the r m alpha are the positions of the they are the lattice vectors, right?
Yes.
And given a particular lattice, the RM alpha is also known. Because we know the primitive vectors, we can construct linear superpositions of those. Okay. Yes. Now we come to Ek. So you said Ek is known.
Yes, sir.
Kahan se aaya wo? Where did we get that?
No, sir, it's not known because we are here to find, if we apply Schrodinger equation, so we'll have to find Ek.
It is not known, right? And yes. What about this E beta? E beta kahan se aaya?
Sir, if we apply atomic Hamiltonian on AM beta.
Very good. So is E beta known or unknown?
These are known, sir.
These are known, right? So yes. The E beta is the atomic orbital energy and that is known. The Ek is the eigen energy of the full Schrodinger's equation, which is unknown, which is what we have set out to find. Okay?
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. You can mute yourself. Okay. So the unknown is also Ek. And here the E beta is known. Fine. So let me write this now in the following way. Wait one second. I want to keep this equation. Maybe I'll have to repeat this again. Okay. Okay. So let me write this equation once again. It was Ek minus E beta some more m alpha. All right, so let me ask now, Pritham, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so Pritham, tell me now, I have this equation, right, in which the B's are unknowns and the EK is also an unknown.
Yes.
So how should I go about solving this equation? Any idea? So you can see that these are knowns, right? Because the chi is known, these matrix elements are known to us, okay? And since the delta u is also given and the chi's are also given, these matrix elements are also known to us, okay? So this is known. This is also known, okay?
Sir, can we multiply by some other
okay, what is it? So let me ask you first, what is it that we have set out to find here? We want to find out EK and we want to find out B, correct?
Yeah.
And EK will give us the energy eigenvalues and the B will give us the wave function, correct?
Yes, sir.
And both of these are embedded into this one equation. Okay. Yeah. Right. Now you go ahead and tell me the method of the solution. I mean, how do I solve this?
So can we use the normalization to...
So tell me, how, what kind of normalization?
The block states are normalized, if we think.
Okay. So then you want to use psi k, right, is one.
Huh? Yes, sir. And
from that, get some condition on the B alphas.
Yes.
Right? Sure, one can do that. Okay. Will that help us to solve this problem?
I don't know, but I'm thinking.
Let me ask you another question. Okay. What do you think is the order of this equation in terms of the B parameters?
That's the number of orbitals in an unit cell.
That's correct. No, when I ask you order of the equation, I'm asking you, is it linear in B? Is it quadratic in B? Is it nonlinear in B?
It's a linear in B.
Exactly. So it's a linear homogeneous system of equations.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Correct. So if it is a linear homogeneous system of equations, what does that immediately suggest to you? What kind of a problem is this?
It's a, we can set the secular determinant to zero.
Correct.
For non-trivial solution.
That's the whole point. So we will write this as a system of linear equations and then set the determinant to zero. And that would give us the E case. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. So does everybody understand this? That we can write this as a system of equations in the B's. Okay, and given that this is a system of equations which is linear in the B parameters, then we can convert this into a matrix form. And as soon as we convert this into a matrix form, we will be able to get the EKs as the eigenvalues of that matrix. Is this clear? Okay, so Ritam, thanks. So that was basically the point, but let me give you one more interpretation and after that we will go over to the solution that Ritam mentioned. Okay, so let's do one more step, which is let's separate out the, there is a summation here over all unit cells and over all orbitals. Let's tease out one of those terms where the m alpha is equal to n beta. Okay, because when m alpha is equal to n beta, then this becomes equal to 1. Okay, so this, when it becomes equal to 1, then it will give us some interpretation. So let's just do that. Okay, so we are going to separate out this equation into two parts. Okay, and now I'm going to ask who is left out. Okay, so Shomita, are you online? Hello, is Shomita online? I should probably ask, are you guys awake? Okay, so Shomita is not responding. Suhas, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Suhas, what I want to do here is to separate out this summation into two parts, one where M alpha is equal to N beta and one where M alpha is not equal to N beta. Okay. So can you tell me what should I write here? Suhas, did you understand the question?
No, sir. Can you rephrase?
You should have told me then, because I was waiting. Okay. I am just asking you. See, there is a summation over M and alpha. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, do you remember what is the M index?
M is a unit cell index.
Unit cell index, correct? And alpha is the?
Alpha is the orbital.
Orbital index. Good. Yeah. So this is a summation over all unit cells and over all orbitals within a single unit cell. Okay?
Yeah.
And this summation now, I want to split it into two parts. One part where I tease out only the nth unit cell and the beta-th orbital, and the other part which is a summation over the rest. Okay. Now you understood?
Yes.
Okay, good. So what should I write next? Did you understand the question?
Yeah, I understand the question, but I don't know.
Okay, fine. So let me start writing. Okay, then you tell me. So I'll write here Ek minus E beta as it is. Okay. Now here I'm saying that you split this into two parts. So one part is when M alpha is equal to N beta.
Yeah.
Okay. See, for example, I have A alpha, A beta, something like this. Okay. Where alpha and beta are being summed over. So all I'm asking is, I want to split this into two parts, one where alpha is equal to beta. So that is only one term. Okay. And then I will get a sum over alpha, A alpha, A alpha. Okay. And then I will have another sum where alpha is not equal to beta. Correct?
Yes.
This is all I'm asking you to do here also. Only thing is, here I don't have two indices which are being summed over like alpha, beta. I only have one composite index, which is M alpha. Okay. So now can you tell me what should I write?
Summation over n.
Okay. Summation over n.
Summation over m.
Okay. Summation over m.
Chi m.
What about the b and the e to the power I k dot r and so on? Will they not come in?
Yeah, they also come.
They will also be there, right? So tell me, what should I write?
B alpha.
Okay. What about the sum over M, and will there be an orbital index here?
No, we have to separate it out. No?
Okay. No, but remember, we are separating out only the beta-th orbital.
Okay. Alpha will be there.
Alpha will be there. But in this summation, we will remove the N beta.
Yeah.
Okay. And write this as it is.
E to the power I k dot R, M alpha, chi, M alpha, M alpha.
No, not M alpha, M alpha. It will be N beta, M alpha. But M alpha here is not equal to M beta, because remember, the summation is over M alpha.
Okay. Yes. Then plus. Okay.
Then plus. Yeah. This is the crucial term. So now tell me what I should write.
Summation over M alpha. In this case, M alpha is equal to N beta.
So we are taking out only one term out of this summation.
Yeah, so b alpha e to the power I k dot
r. Will it be b alpha? Will it be b alpha? Remember, n beta is equal to m alpha. So n is equal to m and alpha is equal to beta. And alpha is a summation index. Beta is
so
the
that chi n beta chi m alpha equal to 1.
Correct. And what will be the b index? B subscript will be?
B beta.
Because here we have teased out the alpha equal to beta term. Okay. See, this whole summation contains all the terms, right? We have separated out that particular term where the m alpha is equal to n beta, and this particular summation now contains all the rest of the terms. Okay?
Yes.
So this will be e to the power I k dot r n beta.
M beta.
And then chi n beta will be 1.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. Good.
Okay. Now tell me what happens to the right hand side. I will do exactly the same thing on the right hand side.
Okay, right hand side summation.
Yeah.
Summation over m alpha.
Okay. Not beta, right?
Yeah. Not equal to beta.
Okay.
Beta.
And the same thing.
Same thing.
Then
plus
what happens to the second term? What about the second term?
B beta.
Correct.
E to the power I k dot r n beta.
Very good.
So this will be delta u.
This will not be delta u. So this is the expectation value of the delta u.
So that will
I n beta. This will not be zero. This will not be one. Or this will not be zero. Okay.
Yeah.
There will be some finite value.
Okay.
Okay, good. You can mute yourself. Okay, so given this, what I can do is I can write this whole thing as ek minus e beta, or let me write ek is equal to e beta plus, there is one term here plus one term here, and then one term here plus one term here. So let me call this 1, 2, 3, 4. This is term 1. This is term 2. This is term 3. And this is 4. Okay. So what do we see here? Okay. We see that the EK, which is the full dispersion, Yes, Shavik.
I have a question, sir. In previous or two more previous slide, you said that each atomic operating on chi mn m alpha gives us e alpha chi m alpha. Sir, here alpha is the orbital represents the orbital wave function of atomic wave function, and m is the unit cell. Now, if in unit cell there is Na and Cl both, then how can we differentiate the energy of Na and Cl? Because if suffix there is alpha, which is indicating the orbital, atom.
Good. Yeah. So, what I did there was, I am counting all of the orbitals in a particular unit cell. Okay. So, let me say that sodium has an s orbital. And what will be the outer orbital of chlorine?
P5.
Yeah, so let's say P, right? So the valence shell of chlorine is? Shovik? Hello?
Hello, sir.
Hello. I can hear you now. What is the valence shell of chlorine?
P orbital.
P shell, right? So the P shell has three degenerate orbitals, px, py, pz. Okay?
Yes.
So what I will do is, I will take a particular unit cell and find out all the different orbitals that are taking part in band formation. For example, sodium is contributing one orbital, the chlorine could be contributing three orbitals. Okay. And now what I will do is I will label or I will count, give an index to each of these orbitals. So the sodium s orbital, 3s orbital, I will call it orbital 1. The chlorine's 3 px py pz orbitals, I will call them 2, 3, 4. Okay. So then what will happen okay. So in that sense, alpha is basically a composite index where the atom index and the atom's orbital index are all sitting together. Okay. So you can just make a count of all the orbitals and then label them according to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, however many are participating in band formation. Does that make sense?
Okay, sir.
So we will encounter this. Just one second. So we will also encounter this in the case of, for example, graphene. So graphene has a honeycomb lattice and it has two carbon atoms per unit cell. Okay. Now, since both of them are carbon atoms, how do we distinguish the orbitals of the two carbon atoms? Okay. So the same question can apply there also. And there also the answer is the same. We can call the first carbon atom's orbital as 1 and the second carbon atom's orbital as 2. Okay. Or if you want to consider, for example, the hybridization also. So there are sp, it's sp2 hybridization. So each sp2 hybridization has three different orbitals. And now you can start looking at 1, 2, 3 of the first atom, 1, 2, 3 of the second atom. Okay, so in total, there are 6 orbitals per unit cell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yes, Shovik, go on. What was your second question?
M alpha equals to N beta representing N sama M alpha sama beta. And N beta not equals to M alpha. That means N not equals to M alpha not equals to beta.
But so hold on. It could be either M is not equal to N or alpha not equal to beta. Both need not be not equal to each other. So M alpha not equal to N beta, you understand? So M alpha not equal to N beta implies that either M is not equal to N, but it could be that alpha is equal to beta, or M is equal to N, alpha is not equal to beta, or M is not equal to N, alpha is not equal to beta. Okay. It's the union of all these.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. If A not equals to N and alpha not equals to beta, then the value will be very less.
That is true. That we will come to later. See, we are not neglecting anything right now. So there is no approximation at all in this equation. It's a completely exact equation. When we start truncating the terms, that is when approximations come in. Okay. All right. So this equation gives us Ek in terms of the E beta, which is the atomic orbital energy. And then there are these terms which are 1, 2, 3, 4. And the numerator is basically the matrix elements of the delta U operator, where the delta U was basically coming from the overlap of the different atoms, right? Because the atoms are started to come closer and the electrons on a particular atom start to feel the potential due to the other atoms, right? So this is the perturbation, and that's what comes in the numerator. One of them is a local term, which means it's an expectation value and a diagonal expectation value, because it's chi n beta. And the other term is an off-diagonal expectation value. Similarly, in the denominator, you have an overlap of the diagonal term, which is chi n beta, and which is 1. And the there is also a non-local term where there is an overlap of the m alpha orbital with the n beta orbital. Okay. So now this equation, however, is unsolvable because we don't know the b parameters. Okay. So this kind of writing this equation in this form is only useful for interpretation. It is not useful for solving. It's not useful for getting the B parameters and the EKs. Okay. To get those, we have to write this as an eigenvalue equation. Okay. So let's first look at a very simple example of a 1D monoatomic lattice and then go over to more complicated examples. A multi-orbital example can be considered next. Okay. So any other doubts? Okay, so next I'm going to ask someone how to reduce this equation for a 1D monoatomic lattice. Okay. Okay. So, is Unnimaya online? No, Unnimaya is not online. Okay. Surbhi, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, Surbhi, I want to take this equation and reduce this to a, or, you know, apply this to a 1D monoatomic lattice. Okay. So, can you guide me how to do that? So basically, I want to find the dispersion for a 1D monoatomic lattice within the tight binding approach. Right? You understood the problem?
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Okay.
So
now, let's if it's a 1D monoatomic lattice, how many values of alpha are possible?
So alpha is our orbital
index. Alpha is orbital index. So how many orbitals are there?
So one for 1D monoatomic lattice.
Where is that one coming from? Is that coming from the 1D? Is it coming from the one atom? Or is it coming from the one atom? Is it? Not from the 1D, right?
No, sir. From one atom.
So why does one atom have only one orbital? If I consider, for example, you know, carbon. Okay. Mm. And the bands of carbon. Do you think only one orbital will contribute?
Sir, it will depend if it's S orbital or P orbital.
Sure. But suppose I say that, you know, there is a multi-electron atom and the P orbitals of one atom and the S orbitals of one atom are able to overlap with the P orbitals of the other and the S orbitals of the other. Okay. So in which case, won't you have multiple orbitals even though it's a 1D monoatomic lattice? You could, right?
Yes, sir. Good.
Yeah. So in this case, we are considering a much more simpler problem where it's a single non-degenerate orbital. So in that sense, I mean, forget spin degeneracy. So in that sense, we are considering, for example, a 1s orbital. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, good. So now you said that alpha can take only one value. Very good. Now, if alpha can take only one value, does it make sense to write B alpha and B beta?
No, sir. We can take only alpha.
We can take this one out, right? The B
yes,
out.
Sir. B alpha so can be taken out.
B alpha can be taken out. Mm-hmm. And here, the B beta, B alpha, B alpha and B beta, all of them come out, right? So the B goes out of the problem.
Hmm. Yes, sir.
So if the B has gone out of the problem, then we have only one unknown left, which is the EK. Correct?
Yes. Yes,
good.
Sir.
Okay. So now what happens to this summation here? Can you tell me what happens to this summation? So let's start writing. Okay. So EK minus E, let's call this S. Hmm. EK minus ES. Let's start writing what happens to this summation. Fine. This summation is a summation over m now, because the alpha is not being summed over. Alpha can take only one value.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So there is now just the B has also gone out. B has been cancelled on both sides.
Yes, sir. Summation over m and
correct.
E raised
summation
to
over m equal to n e to the power I k
e dot rm.
Huh. Kai?
Kai N and Kai M.
Kai. Yes. Okay, plus
e raised to power I k dot r n.
R n, right? That's it, right? Now, you see that e to the power I k dot r n will be there here also on the right hand side. Okay, and I'm going to divide this entire equation by e to the power I k dot r n. Okay, and what that will do is that will introduce here r m minus r n. Okay, and this will become 1. You agree?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now tell me what happens to the right hand side.
Summation to m not equal to n.
Correct.
E raised to power I k dot r m minus r.
Minus r. Right? Yes.
Chi n delta u.
Okay.
Acting on chi m.
Chi m. Okay. Then the second term will be?
E raised to power I k dot, that goes 1.
That is gone. So only one term will remain, which is chi n delta u chi n. Chi n. Right?
Chi n delta u chi n. Yes, sir.
Okay. So you can see that this is diagonal, right? So chi n delta u chi n is a diagonal term, and this is the off diagonal part. Okay. And there is a sum over m not equal to n. So here we are considering the overlap of orbitals which are sitting in two different unit cells, and the expectation value of the delta u operator in with respect to two different orbitals which are sitting in two different unit cells. Okay. And there is also this phase factor here. So what one can do as a first approximation is that this rm minus rn, we can consider that to be summed over just the nearest neighbors, because as you can see, the overlap of two orbitals which are sitting far from each other is going to be smaller and smaller. Okay, so we can start by looking at orbitals which are close to each other but not sitting in the same unit cell, because Surbhi, is that clear?
Surbhi, can you repeat? There was breaking of voice, sir. Okay. I could not clearly hear you. Can you just repeat the statement that you made just before?
So what I was saying was, see, in this summation, you can see that we can restrict this summation to just the nearest neighbors to begin with. And the reason we can do that is because the orbitals here are sitting in different unit cells. And if we go to unit cells which are farther than nearest neighbors, the overlap will become smaller and smaller.
Yes, sir.
A nearest neighbor approximation. Yeah, we can make a nearest neighbor approximation. And in a monatomic lattice, how many nearest neighbors are there?
So 2.
Right? One is Rn plus 1 or Rn plus 1 and Rn minus 1,
right? Yes, sir.
So this part will give us an e to the power ika and e to the power minus ika. Okay. And that, so this we will do in the next class, but basically e to the power ika and e to the power minus ika give us a 2. This is called the Hopping integral, and that. Okay, so function will basically ek equal to es plus minus 2t cos k. Okay, multiplied with some other factors, but basically that's what it is. Okay, so the dispersion will turn out to be, for a 1D monatomic lattice with a single non-degenerate orbital, the dispersion will turn out to be equal to 2t cos k. Okay? And thank you, Subhi. You can mute yourself. But now you can see how to apply this for a 2D lattice. If we had a 2D lattice, we would have to consider in this term all the nearest neighbors of a particular atom. And there you would have nearest neighbors in the x direction, y direction, and so on. So you would have a e to the power ikxa plus kya and e to the power minus ikxa and e to the power minus ikya. And that would give you a 2t cos xa and plus 2t cos, right? So like this, you can construct the dispersion for any given lattice that you have, including multi-orbital lattices. Okay. But we will take a more complicated example next time. Okay, and I'm sorry, I will not be able to stay. Yeah, Shovik, I'm sorry, I will not be able to stay because I'm already late. We started 3:30. Okay, so but in the beginning of tomorrow's class, I'll take up the questions.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.